Hello, classic rock fans. I have one more vlog for you before the end of the year. And this is another concert review. But this is a review of a show that's totally different than anything else I've seen this year. I'm recently back from Las Vegas. And while I was out there, my friends and I saw the Whitney Houston Hologram concert. Woo! So before we talk about that, real quick, I should preface by saying I love going out to Las Vegas. I usually go every year with some friends. Typically, we go out to watch the NFL playoffs, but because of the COVID-19 pandemic, we had to change our plans for this year. And another reason why I love Vegas is that it is a great town for live music. I try to see a show as often as I can whenever I'm out there. First time I was in Las Vegas, I saw John Fogerty's Residency at the Venetian. This would have been in 2016. Awesome show. And then the last concert I saw before the pandemic began was Diamond David Lee Roth at Mandalay Bay in January 2020. And I've talked about that show at length in one of my earliest podcast episodes. Link to that in the description below. And on this most recent trip, a couple of friends and me went to go see the new Raiders stadium. And we saw the Raiders lose to the Washington football team. And at halftime, out of nowhere, Reverend Run from Run DMC came out and gave the halftime performance, which was awesome. It was one of the best parts of the whole game. For the record, that's an absolutely gorgeous stadium, by the way. If you're out in Vegas, you should try to see something at that stadium. It's really nice. But a couple of nights before the game, most of my group went over to Harrah's on the Strip to see the Whitney Houston Hologram concert. Now, if you're not aware, hologram concerts are starting to become more of a thing. I think it all sort of started with that Tupac hologram a couple of years ago, but I'm aware of at least a couple of touring hologram shows. I recall that the Roy Orbison hologram came through Milwaukee, and I looked at getting tickets. And I'm also pretty sure that the Ronnie James Dio hologram tour either came through Milwaukee or was scheduled to. I'm not quite sure how that went down, but I looked at getting tickets to that as well. But ultimately, I decided against it because, quite frankly, the tickets were priced at the same level as a regular national touring act. And that just didn't feel right. Especially because pre-pandemic, there was no shortage of live tours coming through my neck of the woods. I always have concert tickets I want to buy, and I'm not made of money, so I have to make choices on which shows I see when they come through town. And at the end of the day, I just couldn't justify seeing a hologram of Roy Orbison or Ronnie James Dio over the actual human beings in a band that I love. But with Vegas, it was a little different. For one, we went out in December, which is a sort of slow time of year for Vegas. When we looked at some other residency shows that were playing, nothing really drew the group's interest. Anyway, let's talk about what this show is. So the Whitney Houston Hologram got started in February 2020 in the UK. Great timing. But it was announced this summer that there would be a fall residency in Vegas that would go through winter. And I don't know how much longer it's going or if it's going to start touring again. I suspect that this current run of shows is not going to be it. I'm sure there will be future Whitney Houston Hologram shows. But the plans for this show go as far back as 2019, when the company Base Hologram started working with Whitney Houston's estate. So the good news is that this show is going forward with the blessing and support and involvement of Whitney Houston's estate. I think that's incredibly important for something like this. Now, before we talk about the ethics of a show like this and all the controversy that surrounds it, let me just tell you what the actual show was like. So, this is how the show breaks down. You have a nearly invisible curtain dropped down on a stage with a hologram video projected onto it. That's the focus of your eyes through most of the show. Whitney's hologram is projected onto this very thin curtain that's just hard to see unless you're looking for it. Behind the curtain is a live band. That's a plus. And then in front of the curtain, close to the audience, are some live dancers who do some fairly impressive choreography given the space they have. And then it's 15 songs from Whitney Houston's catalog. And the set list is a greatest hits show. And I want to say the runtime was about an hour and a half, an hour 40, something like that. It was a good runtime for a show like this. So let's talk about the pros and cons. The pros of a show like this is that Whitney Houston's catalog is undeniable. I mean, you're talking about some of the greatest pop hits of all time. Songs like How Will I Know, I Want to Dance with Somebody, I Will Always Love You. These are Hall of Fame pop songs, and that's just scratching the surface. I'm not the biggest Whitney Houston fan, but I recognized almost every single one of these songs, and I love a bunch of them. One of the best moments of the night was the opening, where the band played Higher Love. If you didn't know, Whitney Houston does a cover of Higher Love. It wasn't ever released like back in the 80s. You know, Higher Love is that Steve Winwood song, which is a Hall of Fame elite tier pop classic in its own right. At some point, Whitney Houston recorded a cover, but it was never released. And then just a couple of years ago, some DJ got a hold of Whitney's vocal track and put a modern pop production underneath it. And it became a bit of a hit. Like, I heard it on the radio. And it's a really good version, and it was a very cool way to open the show. Got me engaged immediately. So, very impressive with that. Another pro was how enthusiastic the crowd was. Now, I did not go on a night with a packed show. It was not a full house at all. I mean, we're talking like at most maybe a quarter, maybe a third, but I would be surprised by that. We actually got bumped up a couple of rows because the rows in front of us hadn't been sold. So we initially thought the usher had sat us there by a mistake. And when we said something to him, because we didn't want to take anyone else's seat, he assured us that no one was coming for those. So that was kind of a nice little bonus, but it's also an indicator of how full this show was. Now, despite it not being a full house, the people that were there made up for it with enthusiasm. This was one of the most enthusiastic crowds I've ever been a part of. So you got to give it that. It got the crowd engaged. Another positive, the live band behind the hologram and the dancers in front of it were all good. It was live music. I was impressed by that. The dancers had some good choreography. It was fun. The only silly moment was one of the dancers pretended to play the saxophone at one point, and I mean, it was funny, but it was just very obviously fake. Whereas the actual band behind them were playing for real. So I think it's a good thing that the show chose not to just play the studio track along with the hologram video and a couple of dancers. I think it's really important that they have a live band behind it. Adds to the atmosphere, and it is good to hear live music. And we're going to talk about what makes a hologram and some of the downsides of it, but in its defense, if you weren't looking too hard at the hologram, it actually looked pretty good. If you were just enjoying yourself and kind of taking it all in and not super focused on the hologram, for what it is, looked just fine. But take that with a grain of salt, because it is very easy to spot the flaws with the hologram, and I'll get into that in just a moment. And then the last thing, I would say the showroom at Harrah's is a pretty good venue. It's certainly not the best venue I've been to out there, but you know, the seats were comfortable. There was good space. It felt like an appropriate room for a show like this. Because this isn't a marquee show. You have to keep that in mind. This is, I guess, I don't know, like a mid-level show for the Strip. It's the same showroom where you can see Donnie without Marie. So that should sort of give you the idea of what level we're at here. But it was fine. It was no complaints about the venue. It was fine for what it is. So those are the positives. And those are all genuine positives. So in a little bit here, I'm going to sound very critical of this show. But that's not really what I'm trying to convey. To be perfectly honest, I'm torn on how I feel about this concert and hologram concerts in general. So talking to you here is me trying to figure it out. And I really hope you have some thoughts on the matter. And if you do, please post them in the comments below. I'd love to hear what you think about this. Let me know if you've seen this show, or if you want to see this show, or any hologram show, or if you would never see something like this. Now, I've listed the positives, but we do have to get into some negatives, as there were several. First, and it's a minor complaint, but the set list did not include So Emotional. That's a mistake. That's one of her best songs, and it's a lively, upbeat one. If I'm looking at the set list as a whole, there was a good mix of ballads and upbeat pop numbers, but truth is, it skewed just a little bit more to the ballads, and I think if they had subbed out one of those ballads for So Emotional, I think the balance would have worked out a lot better. Because the show opens with Higher Love, and then I Want to Dance with Somebody, and those are the two best parts of the show, at least for me, right away at the beginning. And it's sort of hard to catch that energy if the rest of the show is largely ballads. So that would be my set list critique. Two, I'm shouting at a brick wall here, but way too expensive. We didn't buy the most expensive seats in the house, even though we had really good seats. We bought like the mid-level tickets, which were like $80, but with all the fees, it was $100 a person. That's awful. And I know, I paid it, they got my money, so I can't complain. But I'm going to anyway, because that is, even for Las Vegas, that's a lousy price for a show like this. And I wouldn't blame anybody who chose to see something different out in Las Vegas that was comparably priced or better priced, instead of this, based on the ticket prices alone. I wouldn't blame you for one second about that. There really wasn't anything in this show that would warrant a premium ticket price. A few minutes ago, I was sort of nice about the hologram, but I said it with a bunch of asterisks. If you weren't focused very hard on the hologram, it looked fine. But given that it's the center of attention, if you are focused on the hologram, and you have a good seat, it's going to look a little creepy. Holograms still have that uncanny valley vibe to them. The technology isn't perfect yet. And that's probably a good thing. But the downside is that you're looking at something that's a little unsettling. And I'll explain why that is. So I've seen a lot of conversations around hologram concerts online, and one thing people seem to assume about these shows is that the hologram is constructed from old recorded video performances of these artists. Like the hologram is a sort of ramped up live concert DVD. Like they somehow found a way to isolate Whitney from one of her live concert DVDs and use her performance from that as the actual hologram.
What if they use one of her live performances and turn that into a hologram? I'm assuming that's what they would do. An actual live performance or a concert or a DVD that they may already exist, and then you get to see that live and in person.
Okay. We need to be perfectly clear about this. That is not what these holograms are. And if that's what you're thinking these holograms are, you're going to be very disappointed if you go to see one of these shows, because that's not what this is. These holograms are actually sort of creepy when you think about it. because there's three things that make the hologram: the voice, the face, and the body. So let's talk about how these three things are constructed. The voice is simple. That's just the vocal tracks from the songs. And there is some talking that goes on between a couple of the songs. That's probably pulled from some live recording. And that's also fine. The face is a deep fake. The face is not a recording of Whitney Houston. And that means it's an approximation of her face created via CGI. We're starting to see this technology in movies kind of regularly now. There was Princess Leia and Grand Moff Tarkin in Rogue One. And then just this year, Harold Ramis' character of Egon is sort of reconstructed via CGI in Ghostbusters Afterlife. And this Whitney Houston hologram is sort of the same idea. It's a deepfake face, okay? Now, this deepfake technology is getting very good year after year. In fact, there are some cases where it's so good, it's alarming.
I do a lot of my own stunts, but I also do a lot of industrial cleanup, okay? It's important.
I genuinely feel that deepfakes are going to lead to some, like, serious problems in the next, like, 5, 10, 15, 20 years. Like, I'm actually really worried about the kind of havoc something like this could potentially create down the line. I mean, we live in conspiracy theory times, and this sort of thing, I think, in the wrong hands could be used in really bad ways. Now, the Whitney Houston CGI isn't perfect. So if you look very closely, you can see, oh, okay, it's not actually a recording of her. This is a construction of her face. The body is also constructed. I believe the movements of the body are recorded on a dancer. A stand-in records the movements, the choreography, and then Whitney's body and clothes are superimposed over that recording. So what you have here is sort of a digital Frankenstein's monster. And there's a lot of articles about these holograms that call them zombies. I think Frankenstein's monster is a little more appropriate because it's such a construction. And now it's sort of easy to see why so many people are really opposed to these kind of things.
It doesn't really make much sense to me. It just feels like we're trying to use this person, and even in their death. And that's just, I just can't do it.
Live and in person.
Sometimes you gotta let a person rest in peace.
I agree.
It's just it's a little weird, and it seems like just trying to, in some way that I look at, extend and exploit the
exploit
legacy of somebody.
Exploit is a good word for it. It feels exploited.
And I don't know. I wouldn't be the one to buy the ticket.
Let Whitney Elizabeth Houston rest in peace.
Her middle name was Elizabeth.
And then you have to add in the worst part, which is the fact that Whitney Houston never actually consented to this. And neither did Roy Orbison or Buddy Holly or really any of these dead celebrities whose likenesses are now being portrayed via holograms. This technology is new enough that the celebrities they're using passed away before this tech was fairly mainstream. And there's a lot of artists now who are horrified by it and are very vocal about them not wanting this to happen after they pass away. So I'm going to read you a quote from an article in Variety from this past summer in which Pat Houston, Whitney's sister-in-law, who manages her estate and was Whitney's former manager, was asked about the ethics of using a hologram. And her response was, "In 2011, Whitney and I discussed her idea of an intimate, unplugged concert tour." That is not an answer to the question at hand. Not even close. Whitney very well might have approved of the kind of show that you put on. I would definitely trust Pat to design the sort of show that Whitney would approve of or want to be a part of or whatever. But we cannot say for sure that Whitney approved specifically of the idea of her likeness being used in a hologram concert tour. And I think that's the most important part of this situation here. So I think to pull this off and to really feel good about doing a show like this, you need some important ingredients. And the previously established consent of the artist being represented as the focal point of the show is maybe the most important. And without it, there's a sort of yucky feeling that I just can't quite shake off. Now, that might seem rich from someone who went to see the show, but I felt I had to see a show like this to really start to build an opinion on it. And again, I'm still figuring this out for myself. This is just my gut instinct. Because I think there are some positives for a show like this. And I think there are ways that you can do a hologram show that would be not only just very cool, but also that you could feel very good about. Aside from the hologram, what are the ways that fans can see a live performance of music of artists who have passed away? I can think of three. Barroom cover bands, proper tribute acts, and the very rare occasional event where a movie theater shows like a live DVD of a concert or something like that, okay? And there's limitations with all three. One, barroom cover bands, a good number of them suck, and they play a variety of hits, so they're only going to play like one or two of the songs that you're hoping to hear if there's a certain artist you're looking for. So there's some obvious limitations there. Two, the theater thing. That was like pre-pandemic that every great once in a while I would see that a movie theater was showing like a Rolling Stones concert movie. You know, back when I was in high school, I saw a Neil Young concert film in a theater. And that was awesome. But that was also a one-off in my whole life, you know? And if you're a fan of a band like REO Speedwagon, which I am, sorry, but no theater is ever going to show an REO Speedwagon concert DVD, you know? That sort of event is reserved for only the elite top-tier artists of all time. So, obvious limitations with that. So really the only thing would be like a proper tribute act. Now I've seen a couple of those too. I've seen Bruce in the USA. I've seen Eagle Mania. I've seen Celebrating David Bowie and a Bowie Celebration, different shows. And also Rumors of Fleetwood Mac. And the quality of those shows spans in themselves. Rumors of Fleetwood Mac was a fantastic tribute show. Eagle Mania, less so. And that's not a reflection on the songs, that's a reflection on the tribute artists who are doing said show. And even in the best case scenario, like Rumors of Fleetwood Mac, it wasn't the same as seeing actual Fleetwood Mac. There are still some limitations. And you know what they are, I don't want to get too deep into it because I'm starting to get off track here, but my point is the hologram, at this point, obviously has some limitations as well, but it's a different venue. It's something we can explore. I think there's an idea here that can be sorted out and can be done in an effective way that would keep fan interest alive and also potentially be a great way to introduce fans to said music. Let me give you a scenario of what I think would be a best case for one of these hologram concerts. Kiss. Gene and Paul, still alive, still running Kiss, and they are currently on their farewell tour. And it's their farewell tour because of physical limitations at this point, and who can blame them, okay? It's crazy that they've made it this long doing the sort of show that they do. No disrespect to Kiss at all. It makes sense that they're ready to retire, okay? So much of their identity is based around their live shows. Now, they've talked about how Kiss would proceed in the future, but nothing's really nailed down. If they went the hologram route, there's a way that they could do it in a very effective, cool way that fans could feel good about. One, the four guys are still alive, so everybody could sign off on it if they were comfortable with it, give their consent, and say yes. Not only can you do this after I die, but we're all still alive. You can do this right now. We're okay with it. In fact, we're going to help you put it together. Okay? So you get the consent thing down. Next, you get all four guys in some sort of studio or wherever they record these things. And then you hook up all the stuff that records body movements, and you have them mimic the sort of things that they would do on stage during an actual Kith show. So the body part of the hologram is recorded by the actual band themselves. Same thing with the face. Don't use CGI. Have it be a full recording. Face and body. Everything that the hologram company needs to pull all of the visuals from the actual artist. And then there's no shortage of already existing live Kiss recordings that you could pull the vocal tracks and instrument tracks from. So instead of having a live band behind the holograms of Kiss, you could have the actual holograms playing along to the actual band's live recordings of the songs being presented, and have plenty of room on the stage for pyro and dancers and just all the other showbiz stuff that a band like Kiss would have. And if the artists themselves are involved, they're obviously going to negotiate a deal that will benefit their estates after they pass away, if the show goes on after they pass away. But in any case, now you have this hologram show with nothing unethical or uncomfortable about it, nothing weird with the actual hologram composition, and as close to a live presentation for that actual band as you can get. Now, am I saying that that would be better than a really well-established and really well-put-together Kiss tribute band? Well, that's subjective. I think it could be. I also think it could be worse. It depends on the fan. My point is simply that it could be good. It could be something that many fans would really enjoy. That's my thought on how it could be done well. And unfortunately, because of technology limitations and because the artists that are in these current holograms were not alive when they were being developed so that they could consent to it, we're not there yet. And I'm having a hard time getting over that. I don't regret seeing the show. I really enjoyed the show, to be honest. But that's more of a compliment to Whitney's catalog. I enjoyed the show I went to, but there are some undeniable problems with the ethics of this kind of show that need to be resolved. I guess I'm glad that some of these shows exist now, because it's getting these thoughts in the heads of artists who are still alive, and hopefully those artists are making their decisions, and if their decision is yes, let's do something like that after I retire and or pass away unexpectedly, let me help design the show. I think that's really important, and that's something we should keep an eye on in the future. A best possible future for hologram concerts is not only artist consent, but artist involvement. When they retire from the road, they should look into this kind of thing, and they should, you know, be involved with its creation. Now, I have no illusions. These sort of holograms are really only going to be for big, pop, showy kind of bands. There ain't never going to be a Neil Young hologram concert, but that's fine. If we're talking about rock and roll, I think bands like Kiss, Motley Crue, Aerosmith, you know, AC/DC, these big, showy rock bands could get involved and help create a hologram concert that is not only ethically comfortable to see, but also kick-ass. So if the Whitney Houston hologram concert comes to your town, I would advise consider seeing it. Mull over how you feel about these things, but if you choose to go, it's, at the end of the day, a celebration of music, and you shouldn't feel guilty about it. If the ticket's a good price, and it's music that you love, at the end of the day, I think you might enjoy something like this, but it's going to be up to you and how you feel about this sort of thing. And now, that's all I got for you. So, if you've seen the show or any other hologram show, please tell me what you think in the comments below. Otherwise, please subscribe to this YouTube channel and find us on our social media posted below. If you're a fan of classic rock, I do a podcast about classic rock. I think you should check that out. And as this is the last video of the year for this channel, I just want to say once again, thank you to everybody who's tuned in 2021. We did a lot of fun stuff on this channel that I'm very proud of, and I really appreciate everybody who's taken the time to either listen to the podcast or watch my videos here. I appreciate all of you, and we got a lot of great stuff coming in 2022. Stay tuned, and thanks again. Good night.